king Hosea saw the Lord made him to prosper. So one key to prosperity is prayer. One key to prosperity is prayer. Prayer is as important as thinking. Amen. Prayer is as important as breathing.
Amen. Pray without
ceasing. The Bible says that pray without ceasing. When they tell you that when a car is rolling, it doesn't stop. That's what it says. A car is going without stopping. So it means you have to pray without stopping. Everywhere I am, Makote Lake, wherever the devil is, let something happen. The Bible says pray at all times. Because you don't know which of your prayers will work. That's why you see a man come to church like in a year nothing happens. And then suddenly there's a total restoration. That means don't give up in your prayers. Don't be moved by what you see. Don't be moved by what you hear when you pray. A sister that gave a testimony, she came to me and said, it's not happening. Like indirectly. And I said, don't worry, just forget about it. God will do it. I said, when you pray, you forget about it and you keep doing what God has asked you to do, God will do it. God is doing it for someone here in the name of Jesus. Amen. My desire is that your prayer life shall be strong and mighty after this anointing service in the name of Jesus. Amen. Go with me to Acts 12, 1 to 6 for your consideration, please. Go with me to Acts 12, 1 to 6. I am teaching, I am not preaching. That's why I'm not in a hurry. So please don't be in a hurry. Acts 12, 1 to 6. Well, you see, one of the verses says, the only time evil prevails in the life of a man is when you refuse to do anything. That's what it says. So even Herod the king, okay, that's it. Now, let's read. About that time, who? Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex certain of the church. Not everyone in church, oh, because not everyone in church is going somewhere. If you don't have a destiny, the enemy will not even worry. The enemy only pursue those with a destiny. I heard this from my father. He said that on a football field, nobody goes after the man without the ball.
Amen.
The man with the ball is the object of pursuit. In fact, wherever the goalkeeper is, they don't even, cameraman doesn't even look at him. He's not important at that moment. The man who has the ball is the man that the others are pursuing. So it doesn't matter where you are now. The fact that the devil is after you is because you are going somewhere. It is because you have a destiny. The devil is not after everyone. King Herod had to go after some of the people of the church. Not everybody. So not everybody is going somewhere. I decree that you are going somewhere in the name of Jesus. Any death waiting for you anywhere is cancelled by fire, by thunder in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that even in prison, that Joseph was in charge. Joseph wasn't selling anything in prison. He was only in charge because he was a prayerful man. Joseph prospered even in prison. He was doing no business in prison. But he prospered because of his prayer life. He prospered because of his fellowship with God. He knew God because of his prayer life. And the time he spent with God in prayers. The only job God Joseph did in prison was to pray and to preach the word of God. I declare from this encounter, as you are anointed today, wherever the foot of your feet will tread, you shall possess in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say anywhere you go from now, you will take over in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say every office you enter from today, you will be noticed in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Now quickly, let's look at a few hindrances to prayers. A few hindrances to answer prayers. You will notice that everybody prays, but not everybody gets answer to prayer. I begin to tell God, I say, God, I don't want to pray a long prayer. When someone comes to me, let me just say, in the name of Jesus, you are healed. I saw a revelation where God said, there will be a time in one of our services where everyone will be healed. God, you understand it. Every wheelchair will be lifted.
Amen.
He said blind eyes will be popping like popcorn.
Amen.
You understand? He said short legs will begin to pop out.
Amen.
He said people who have lost their breasts, they will grow out in front of you.
Amen.
You understand? Your amen does not sound like you understand what I'm saying.
Amen.
Every time I tell you something, do it. Every time I say it will happen, it doesn't matter when, I know that God will do it. That will be your story in the name of Jesus. Every prayer request in here is therefore answered in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So today we shall look at the basics. We shall look at the ABC reasons why most prayers are not answered. You know, one of the modalities of good Christian practice is when a believer begins to understand basic Christian principles and begin to pursue them. If, have you noticed that it is small things that kill mighty men of God? You hear that a man of God has tata and died. What an abomination. Yet that a rich man has headache and he's been everywhere and that headache killed him. Small things. Today, as you leave this place, God is giving you wisdom to take over your territory in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Friends, nothing makes you a principal like principles. Basic principles. Nothing sets you free from principalities like basic principles. Nothing makes you outstanding like basic principles. I want you to know that God is still in the prayer business.
Amen.
God is still a answering prayer amen. God.
Yes, amen.
Every Sunday, you know, so the past 1 month, it's been raining in the morning, 9 o'clock. And me and my children will say, it cannot rain. Because the devil is only strategic, he's not powerful. He releases rain so that some will say, I cannot go to church today because of rain. You don't understand. You must be sensitive in the spirit. Basic things. But you will not believe that that's what the devil is doing. But every of those 4 weeks, me and my children, we are in the tower, begin to declare, rain, we command you now. Class of rainfall, move back to sender. And behold, we call class of sunshine. And behold, it happens like that before God and man. Because God has vowed that every 1 year must be changed this year in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Go with me to John 16, 23, 24. John 16, 23, 24. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He says, in that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very, very truly, I say unto you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete.
Amen.
So that means a man that always pray is a man that always have joy. A man that always pray is a man that always have peace.
Amen.
A man that always pray is a man that always has favor.
Amen.
Nothing can move me. Why? Because I prayer is like breathing.
Yes.
There are no two ways around it. No two ways around it. No two ways around it. Make up your mind to say my generation must hear me. So my in families where there are a lot of trouble, but they are just folding their arms. God said, I'm looking for who to pray to change that situation. Someone must come out of that family and say, enough is enough.
Yes.
Enough is enough. Something must happen. I must move into my destiny. Where you are is not where you're supposed to be. Not only you, all of us.
Oh, yeah.
I'm supposed to be a quadrillion and I'm not still. Physically. In the spiritual, I am. In the physical, I am not. Why? Because someone is trying to stop that from happening. I'm supposed to have, we are supposed to have more than the real than now. We have not had it. Because someone is fighting it. Don't just sit in that family and things are going contrary and you are folding your arms and you are chasing ships. When God has ordained something bigger than a one ship worth less than 100 pounds.
Amen.
And God is saying that he or she is a landlord, but they are moving like tenants. Let our testimony, look this week from tomorrow, I told my wife, I said, I will not stop praying till something, till I see a blind eye pop open. So I will not stop praying and fasting from tomorrow till something happens that the world will hear me.
Amen.
You think that you'll die, you'll not die.
Amen.
Spend time with God, God will empower you to be the head of that family, to be the head of your generation, to bring a 360 degree around in your family.
Amen.
Some people here, by the grace of God, your family will be a household name in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
By your encounter with God this year, I say your family is moving ahead in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Whoever has vowed that you are remaining in one spot, that man catches fire now in the name of Jesus. If that amen is for you, shout hallelujah. So that tells me, John 16, 23, 24. Let's read. He said that, have you asked nothing in my name? Ask, and what you shall receive, that your joy may be fulfilled. So that tells us that the name of Jesus is the telephone number of heaven. What are you asking? You're asking in the name of Jesus. You are asking in the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is the number you will should first die to be connected to God. That's why you see every prayer we have here, we say, Father, in the name of Jesus. The other way around is not wrong, but the name of Jesus is one of the things that will obviously bring about our answered prayers. I remember once we went to the hospital, and this lady was in a ICU. And me and my wife just went there, and we prayed for water, and we say, before we said, in the name of Jesus, she was up. So, in the name of Jesus is the telephone number of heaven. The first reason for unanswered prayers is lack of praise and adoration. Say with me, lack of praise and adoration.
Lack of praise and adoration.
Let's recite the Lord's Prayer. Go to me, go with me to Matthew 6, 9 to 13. Matthew 6, 9 to 13. Matthew, I want to show us something there. It's very important. Matthew 6, 9 to 13. Matthew 6, 9 to 13. After this manner, read together. Therefore, pray ye, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, that will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Carry on.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. This prayer is all about God. It started and ended with God. The emphasis on the Lord's Prayer is more on God and not on us. Amen. Does that make sense?
Yes.
The emphasis on the Lord's Prayer is more on God and not on us. Most Christians get unanswered prayers because they spend time exalting their problems instead of praising Jehovah. I told you a story where I went to the house and all I was doing was, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. That was praising God. And the Lord looked at me and said, this man, something happened now. And as I went, I just said, in the name of Jesus, madam, you are healed. At the spot, she was healed.
Amen.
Why? Because of praise. Yeah. Most of us, when we have a problem, we just start, I don't know, God do it for me. God, we don't praise God. We don't exalt God. We don't adore God. If you go to the a kingdom, people who have come from the royal families, when you go to the Igwe, what do? Don't bow, nor if they'll give you anything, they'll drive you anyway, if you don't bow. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. It's like when you go to chieftaincies, when you go to the king, you have to first of all bow and say Igwe, whatever you say, that's Nigeria. And then now the king is so happy that you're bowing to him, the king will now answer your question, what you want. But most of us, when we go into the presence of the Lord, we don't adore him. We don't praise him. We just go and we start asking for demands. Father, give me this and this and this and this. Father, give me rice and beans and stew. They give you rice. Even the children of Israel, that's why they stayed in the promised land in the wilderness of 40 years. A journey of 13 days took them 40 years. Why? Because they gave them what? Manna. They said, manna is not good. Lord, you are not giving us meat. They gave them meat. So they begin to ask demand upon demand upon demand. They were not thinking of praising God for all the other things that God has done for them. Notice that I can pray for you and believe God for you, but I cannot praise God for you. Does that make sense? I can pray for you. I can believe God for you, but I cannot praise God for you. And there are certain things that will only go by praise. There are certain problems that will only disappear by adoration. So it is your responsibility to give God all the praise. And I see him answering the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Someone will wake up at night and an ant is passing by. And they'll be so much afraid and you'll scare them shouting, Jesus. And the next thing you see, they start binding. I rebuke, I curse. You are binding and you are not thinking about who answered the prayers. Who answered the prayers? Jesus. So what you do is you forget about what is happening. You praise God first. You give God adoration. And then you go back and challenge the thing. In the name of Jesus, I command you, move. That's why I keep saying that people pray for 20 minutes. I don't know what they are praying for 20 minutes. All day they've been roaming around doing other things. Then when it's time for them to go to bed, they pray for 20 minutes. Sometimes 9 hours, I'm still there. Father, I thank you. God, I'm still praising God. I've not started praying. 9 hours, no prayer yet. Only praising God, only adoring God. Father, I celebrate you. It is your hunger that brings about the change. Live with a mind that will change your generation. Live with a generational mindset. Most Christians will spend minutes praying for their problems, but they forget to adore the God who is going to bring about the miracles. Listen, when counselors in kingdom go before the king, what do they do? Like I said, they bow down first and then praise the king before they ask for anything. Don't wait for solutions to problems before you start exalting God, before you start praising God. You think I'm celebrating God? I don't have needs. I have needs more than everyone here. I have needs for all your needs joined together. There's no amount of my needs. But I forget about those needs and I say, Jesus, you reign. I said, like I said, I don't pray for myself. Now I pray for souls. Lord, where are the souls? 1 billion souls. 1 billion. He didn't tell me 1 billion souls. He said, I'm bringing to you 1 billion families.
Amen.
You can know if you get it outside, then see your prophecy. Hallelujah. Your prophecy shall be answered in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Friends, we need to adore God and not our problems. We need to adore God and not our problems. The truth is that if you cannot praise God on earth, like I said on the Holy Ghost Fire night, then don't think of going to heaven. Heaven will not be sweet for you. Because in heaven, all we'll be doing is glory, glory. So if you don't learn to do it on earth, then heaven will bore you. You say, God, let me go back. So learn to praise God on earth. And when you get to heaven, you'll be acquainted to what you've been doing on earth. That will be your story in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
We went out for charity one Saturday. That was in Wolverhampton. And we met this man who was... I forgot what he had now, but he had a sickness. I gave him testimony here once, where he was vomiting blood and he could not keep anything in his tummy. I forgot what he had, but he was sick, gravely sick. So he kept vomiting blood and anything he ate came out. And I said, God, I thank you because you have done it.
Yes.
I said, whatever is in there is God. That's what I told him. I said, whatever is in there is God in the name of Jesus. I said, say amen. Before that, I led him to Christ. I said, say amen. He said amen. And the next day, he was totally healed when we went back. In fact, where he was a small hole where, you know, homeless people, they don't have where to live. And the next day, I said to him that day, I said, as we have prayed, it is done. I said, the next day, they'll come back and take you to a house. It did not happen the next day. It happened that same week. They came back and moved him from that place and took him to a house.
Amen.
You don't understand? As we were praying, me and him, somehow in the council was under pressure to change his life. As we were adoring God, I met someone there the next day when I went there. I met someone there from the council who came and gave him food. Man, someone who has been ignored for long, he has been in the cold for days and weeks. But by a word, by adoration, by praise, story changed. Give you 160 degrees turn around. That will be your story in the name of Jesus. Some of us don't believe some of these testimonies because we don't understand how that can happen. God can do anything and everything.
Amen.
I cannot wait to start seeing the eyes of people popping open like that. I cannot wait to see dead legs coming back to life.
Amen.
You'll see things here that the world has never seen in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And some of you, God will use your hands to perform those miracles in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
If that is you, shout a mighty amen.
Amen.
So don't wait till you have a solution before you start praising God. Praise God at all times. Be careful for nothing, the Bible says. Philippians 4, 6 to 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and what? And supplication. With thanksgiving. By prayer, by supplication, with thanksgiving. Let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guide your heart and your mind through what? Christ Jesus. Be careful for nothing. Nothing should put you under pressure.
Amen.
We've had things, me and my wife, that if not of God, we would have said, man, give up. You don't understand. When we pray for you and something leaves you and go back to the enemy, they come and fight us. That's what happens. So we are not only fighting our own foundation, we are fighting all the foundations. Then you want a man like this to sleep. When the Bible says that the enemy roams around like a roaring lion, when? At night. doing what? Looking for who to devolve. Who would he want to devolve first? The person that is fighting his kingdom. As I'm speaking now, there's confusion in their camp. As I'm speaking now, in your village, they are fighting among themselves. Amen. Look at how they're answering amen.
Amen.
If that is you, let me hear your amen.
Amen.
Another hindrance to prayer is praying and singing at the same time. This week, God began to give me this, what I'm teaching you now, all like that, alive. I wrote it in a book. As he was giving me, I was writing it. So this is a word from God. This is not a word for someone should not think that I'm preaching about them. I don't preach about people. I preach. God cannot give me a word directly for you. But he can give me a word to preach on the altar that will affect your life.
Amen.
That is why every time we preach here, someone will say that preaching was for me.
Yes.
Every time.
Amen.
Because that word, God will come here for someone whom he knows is hungry, whom he knows had an expectant heart. Most believers, they sing, they come to church and they sing at the same time. So they flow in the things of God and they flow in the things of the world at the same time. Most believers are very good at doing church and doing the world at the same time. Some people don't like these messages I'm preaching now.
Yes.
But if we don't preach it, how shall they know?
Oh, yes.
People like when they go and they begin to console them. Hey, in the name of Jesus, tomorrow 100,000 will enter your account. They don't tell them. They don't prepare them for the coming of Christ. And that's why God called us, that we should go and prepare the saints for the coming of Christ. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his salvation? Friends, if your focus is not heaven, then you don't have a focus. If your focus is not heaven, then you don't have a focus. James 4:4 says, you are idolatrous people. That's what the Bible says to us. Don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. If God is my enemy, who will answer my prayer? If God is my enemy, who will answer my prayer? Have you not seen many believers rushing to church on Sunday and then rushing to the nightclub later on?
Yeah.
Rushing to the beer parlor later on? Rushing to you? Look, there is no way you can see me in places. There are some places I never go. Organized party, you don't see me. Difficult. Many believers leave the church on Sunday and they go to Heavenlies. You don't understand. They leave the church on Sunday and they begin to go and chase someone's wife, someone's husband. You don't understand. That will not be our story in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Have you not seen many believers rushing to church on Sunday and then going to defraud others after church? I was speaking to one of my daughters who was telling me that she was talking to someone, and I was happy to hear that she was talking to someone. And then later on, she began to tell me that the person has had a wife, but the person and the wife, they are no longer together. You know, there is something in me that rotates when I hear a lie. My wife knows. I say, liar. I'll not tell the person, but I'll tell my wife, I say, liar, this is what I hear, this is a lie. Something in me just got angry. Something just reacted in me. And I started telling her that it is a lie. That a man is still with the wife and only wants to have her for dinner. You understand what I mean? She did not believe me, but it ended up happening like that. She was telling me how she feels sorry for the guy because the wife is treating him badly. And I knew that she is falling for him because of sorrow. That's what happened. You know, I was a player. You know that, sir. I was a player, so we know those games. That's why in the world there are so many Jezebels. You know what's a Jezebel? They bring sorrow. They will cry here. You think that your pastor is such a liar. You know that, sir. Jezebel, that they will cry here and you think that one of your members is so bad. But whereas they are manipulating, using manipulation, the sorrow they are bringing is manipulation for you not to like someone else. No one here shall walk out of love in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And that is a game men play these days. Jezebel's spirit appearing so pitiful, easily fall for that. People appearing so, you think the Jezebel spirit began to cry, you think that something is happened. But whereas they are just making that up. No one here will set you up in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
She was showing me pictures of a man who she claims they are just friends. Then I asked her, why do you keep pictures of a man you claim you are just friends? A man you claim you are just friends and you keep the pictures. Because I said in one of our services, I said, what you keep looking at, your heart begins to desire it. There are some of us looking at us and me here. There are some pictures you must delete in your phone. You don't need them. There are some numbers you must delete in your phone. You don't need them. My wife keeps telling me that you have an anointing to delay numbers. I said, why would I not delay numbers? If I speak to you about Christ and I realize that you are going somewhere else, I delay your number. You are not ready. You are not right. You are not right to receive. Even Jesus, when he went to seven towns and did not receive, what he cleaned his legs and went to another town. They are not ready. When they are ready, they'll give their life to Christ. You don't understand? I have learned something from my exes. One of my exes knew that I'm already married. And she still connived with somebody else to come and ask me if she has another chance in my life. You don't believe it. And a man who does not know where he's going will say, well, she knows already I'm married now. Let me just do my thing. You sell your destiny by a 5 minute act. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. Yeah. I know someone is saying that you are saying these things, their children here. If you don't teach them, the world will teach them. That's the truth. That's what God told me. Teach them. You don't teach them God's ways, the world will teach them their way. A married woman I was looking at, I was talking to, they were about 50 something years old, I met at work. And she said to me that the family does not respect her. I said, how will your family respect you? You go out, come back late, you get drunk, you are chatting online with people you call your friends till 1 a.m. How do you want your family to respect you? Where is your dignity? Where is your integrity as a woman of God? What are you chatting with a man online when your husband is somewhere else at 1 a.m? When the Bible says that the devil roams around like a, and you wonder why you fell for him. The devil roams around like a roaring lion. At what time? At midnight, at 1 o'clock, at 2, and you are chatting. So you have just opened a route for the devil to come and destroy your marriage, to come and destroy your family, to come and destroy your fruitfulness, to come and destroy your business. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. Yeah. I said to her, make principles that a man will look at you and say, this is my wife. Make principles. Be a woman, a man of integrity. Let the man that wants to marry you know that you have principles. Any man that does not follow your principles is not made for you. Make principle that a man will look at you and respect you. He will go around and not see any woman that told him that at 9 o'clock I don't chat, I don't talk. Talk to me the next day. Integrity. Make principles that heaven will be in a hurry to change your story. There are some things you do and heaven is like this one. What I'm about to do. Something will happen. That will be your story in the name of Jesus. Amen. I said that will be your story in the name of Jesus. Amen. How will a woman say, I am going to do shopping with a man she calls a friend? And what is she stopping? On her ways. No, come on now. With a man she calls my friend and she's going to shop on her way with that man. How would a man not want to see how that on her way looks on her? It's not a man, no. It is you that tempted the man. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. Amen. I said to her, I said, drinking, getting drunk, staying out late, chatting with different men at midnight, at 1 a.m. in the morning is not of God. That is the flesh. That is the flesh. And I said, you think you can get respect like that? I said, where is your integrity? If you are married, people you call friends should know your principles, like I said. I said to her, respect is earned, so go and earn their respect. Does that make sense? I said, go and earn their respect. That will not be our portion in the name of Jesus. Amen. She started telling me that the guy is very honest and very sweet. And I said to her, wait until he finishes with you. What he's saying to you, that that you are sexy. Indirectly, he's looking at something else. Not that you are sexy. You are not sexy. You are not.